Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here today for the governor's budget address. My name is Kelsey Pritchard. I'm the communications director in the governor's office. Just a reminder for everybody on the phone line to mute your lines now by pressing *6. And during the Q&A portion of the press conference, you can unmute by pressing #6. For those in the room, if you have questions, please use the mics at the table. With the governor today is the Commissioner of Finance and Management, Jason Dilges, and Kim Malsom-Risden, who's the governor's senior advisor and the Secretary of the Department of Health. And now I'll turn it over to Governor Dennis Daugaard.
Thank you, Kelsey. I don't have any opening remarks other than to thank you all for joining the conference. And with that, I'll open it up for any questions on the budget address or any topic.
I've heard that there might be some reluctance potentially in the House about a tax increase or about expanding Medicaid. Can you talk a little bit about how you might overcome that?
Well, I think there's always a reluctance to increase tax rates. I think that's not atypical. I myself am loath to raise tax rates. So I think in the case of some of our expenditure proposals, they are not dependent on tax rates. The things I outlined in the budget proposal, including Medicaid, are not dependent on any tax rate changes. They're more dependent on the discussions that are underway with the federal government. And I'm hopeful about those, and yet realistic that they may not be fruitful. The devil's in the details. And we have an earnest interest in the Indian Health Service in adapting and enabling this change, but they have limited resources available to them, and there's also complexity in the federal bureaucracy. And so the key is to be able to enable Medicaid, those eligible for Medicaid who are accessing healthcare to access it through Indian Health Services, and how that is defined, what constitutes accessing healthcare through Indian Health Services. Can it be through someone who contracts with IHS? So if I go to that contractor, yes. Or how thorough must the contract be? What kind of bureaucracy will allow or frustrate the signing of contracts like that? Those are the devils that are in those details. And so we'll see how that goes. And those conversations are ongoing. Yes, Kara.
I can never get the button pushed. I'm just wondering if this plan for more Indian Health Service receiving 100%, right, payment,
yes.
Whether they go to Indian Health Services or another provider, right? That's really what we're talking about. What will that do you think, to healthcare on the reservations?
Well, we have talked with our Healthcare Solutions Coalition about a number of ways that we want to not just shift funding, because it can't be just a monetary shift. That might help our state budget, but it doesn't help Native Americans, and it has to be helpful to them as well, or why should they support it? And we want improved health care for all South Dakotans, including those that have traditionally been underserved. And it's true that people in rural areas, in all rural areas, have less access, but particularly on the reservations, even less access than those in other South Dakota rural areas. And so we want telehealth to be available to them. And we have some pretty good telehealth services developed in South Dakota. I'd say we're a leader in the nation in telehealth services in some areas. We want transportation availability to them. So if they have to go to a provider off the reservation or get transportation, we want medical assistance to them. We want help We want people on the reservation or remotely to be able to counsel patients there about drug interactions, about mental health needs, about things that are needed. And so it can't be just a funding shift. There has to be improvement of services. And maybe Kim could touch on that a little bit more.
Thank you, Governor. I guess what I would add to those comments is some dedicated work that members of the coalition, which includes tribes, healthcare providers outside of the tribal system, the Indian Health Service itself, legislators, and others. So that's the composition of that group. Are working on strategies to specifically increase access through Indian Health Services itself. That's primarily the telehealth that the governor just described. That group is also looking at how to increase specific behavioral health services, because that is a very large need in our reservation communities. And so we've got a subcommittee that's specifically looking at both chemical dependency and mental health services.
And then aren't we also looking at neonatal as a specific targeted specialty, where we have a high birth rate on some of our reservations and a high mortality rate, higher than the norm mortality rate for infants, and yet we have some great neonatal care in South Dakota if we can provide it through referrals or through telehealth visits or a combination of those things?
I would just clarify prenatal care.
Prenatal
so
care.
Helping pregnant moms.
Well, I think what happens is the coalition is, this group that Kim is working with, is offering examples to Health and Human Services and any health services. Here is a system that we think would work. Like, for example, telehealth. We have good developed telehealth services in South Dakota. Why can't we provide lots of health services that IHS can't provide today because they don't have enough professionals that are willing to be on reservation in health facilities providing care? Why can't we have a contract with a telehealth provider so some of these specialty cares, maybe your initial visit with a dermatologist or with an orthopedic surgeon can be via telehealth, or after a procedure that maybe has to take place off reservation, maybe the follow-up visit can take place via telehealth. And so things like that, we're offering ideas and examples, and so that they fully understand the changes in their procedures and contracts that they'd have to undertake to make that work. And if there's barriers, how can we overcome those barriers?
Are there questions in the room?
The Regents this year, I don't even think, came forward with a tuition freeze proposal. Can you just talk a little bit about how you came to the kind of creative thing of paying down the debt to freeze tuition?
Well, I would say I'm a creature of habit, and we did this once before, and it worked very well, I think. It helped us utilize one-time money in a way that freed up an ongoing resource. And yet it didn't create, with the one-time money, a dependency at the level of the one-time funds. So if we could take, in some states, they take a $42 million lump sum and they give $42 million more to the schools. Well, what do you do next year when they want $42 million again and you don't have it? So rather, we try and figure out a way to convert a one-time resource into a sustainable ongoing resource. And we did that 2 years ago, and we're doing that again this year. And so it's really a replication of something that worked pretty well in the past. And also, I will say, to add more thing, it appeals to my nature, because I'm debt averse. And so I like less debt, because I see the problems that debt causes for individuals and families, and I see the problems that debt has caused for states and our federal government. So if we can maintain and manage our debt and even reduce our debt where we can and provide these benefits of ongoing sustainable funding, that's a win-win for me. It appeals to my nature.
Just one follow-up on a separate topic. We just heard from the Democrats upstairs. They were concerned, I guess they called it a mere reference to teacher pay in the budget. they want to see more action now from you. How would you respond?
Well, I'm going to be presenting a proposal in my state of the state. We have some pretty significant policy decisions coming up in this session, and I felt it would be better to focus on the Medicaid policy decision with this address and focus on the Blue Ribbon Task Force more so with the State of the State address. That way people can swallow and absorb the questions and answers and information about each in turn rather than try to deal with it all at once. There's still plenty of time after the State of the State to, and it's not as if this is not a well-developed issue that's been publicly vetted quite extensively. So it's not as if there's going to be a big fact consumption that has to occur and data assimilation that has to occur before people can make choices among policy proposals that may be competing during session. There's lots of data and facts that have come out during the last, say, 7-8 months of study in this area. In fact, as you know, a lot of people complained, oh, why don't we move immediately to solutions, which people are want to do when they feel confident that their knowledge is so vast that they understand immediately the most obvious policy solutions. And I find in the end that generally is not true.
You said at the end of your speech 63 FTE reductions.
Yes.
Where are those coming from? Who are those people?
Well, we're going to cut a number of FTE from the Science and Technology Authority that will become federal employees, not state employees. So those people won't lose jobs. They're just, we're going to reduce our employees in the Department of Corrections. We're seeing in the juvenile justice arena, you know, we closed the East campus and consolidated some of our juvenile facilities, and we're seeing that headcount continue to decline slowly. So there'll be some reduction there. Also in the Department of Labor and Regulation, I mentioned they're losing some federal funding, and we're going to replace some of that with general funds, but we're also going to cut some staff members. And most of those we're going to be able to deal with through retirements and attrition.
Do we have any questions on the phone line?
Hey, Governor, it's Jerry Oster, WNAX.
Yes, Jerry.
So on the Medicaid expansion, as you watch that, and we've been watching Iowa, they're waiting on a federal waiver. Isn't there a lot of moving parts in waiting for the feds on their end, if especially moving ahead with the coalition solutions?
Oh, yes. It's not something that will happen overnight. In fact, it may not happen in time to begin treating an expanded population July 1. It's possible that it could, but I think it's also possible that it may take longer than that. What I'm asking for the federal authority to start coverage July 1 if we're able to get it done by then. If not, then maybe we'll end up getting the expansion, again, assuming all this comes together, and as I said in the speech, it's not a done deal, but if it all comes together right, and the money is there, and the tribes support it, and the legislature supports it, and gives the federal authority, then maybe we'll end up expanding in October, if that's when we get our Medicaid plan amendment approved. Is that fair to say, Kim? Jason,
yes.
Do you agree with that?
Yes.
Okay, yeah.
But right. I say there's a lot of moving parts, in other words.
Yes, there are a lot of moving parts. I would say the sequence of steps is we have to have confidence that the changes in the way Indian Health Services are funded will produce the dollar savings that make it budget neutral for the state cost side of things in FY2021. Then we'll expand. And to do that, then you have to have tribal consultations. They have to approve it. And then if the legislature has approved the budget authority, then we'll write a plan amendment that we submit to the federal government. And then if they approve that plan amendment or they change this or that to it, then once we've agreed on the plan amendment that works for both sides, then we essentially expand our eligible population and start enrolling those people. But that might not happen on July 1. The money would be theoretically available, and that's possible to occur July 1, but it might occur after if it takes longer.
Now, along those lines, you've always said in the past that you've not considered the federal government to be necessarily stand up, you know, for the money part of it. Have you changed your mind there? Are you still skeptical that the money is going to be there?
Well, I think it's easier to accept the notion that we can manage a change they might try to impose upon the states after 2021 if we're able to swallow the step up to 90 through savings in our existing funding. In other words, if we had to come up with that $57 million ourselves, beyond the ongoing increases in general funds that we need for education and for our existing Medicaid population and our existing employees and corrections and all the other things that we have to pay for. Remember, the total ongoing funding increase for the FY17 budget is $59 million. So let's imagine it's 2021 and we've got to come up with $57 million for the expansion population alone. That leaves a $2 million revenue increase for everything else that we're already funding in the budget. The whole budget description that I gave today outside of expansion would be funded by $2 million. Well, that's not realistic. So if we're able to swallow a Medicaid expansion with existing funding, then to the extent that the federal government switches us out a little bit, you know, they're going to be doing that to every state, and we would be in a position to moderate the impact of that, I think, or manage the impact of that more easily if we're not already struggling just to handle the expansion on existing terms.
Are there any questions on the phone line? Any more questions in the room? All right, well, thank you all.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks.